The kingdom of God is not meat and drink and all the rituals that religion would try to dress the kingdom of God up with, but it's in righteousness. How many righteous people here tonight? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I got mine as a free gift and earned one little bit of it just given to me. Hallelujah. It's the righteousness of God. It exceeds the righteousness of the Pharisees and of the law and everything else that man understood about God since the fall of Adam. Father just handed it to us as a gift. Wow, it's amazing. How many holy people here tonight? Hallelujah. Yes. I know that some of you are reluctant to raise your hand because somebody told you you weren't supposed to say that you were holy, but I want you to know that God gave us a gift of holiness. He gave us righteousness and holiness as a gift. You can refer to it in Ephesians 4:24, for example. If you don't believe me, listen to Paul. If you don't believe Paul, then listen to Zechariah as he prophesied in Luke chapter 1, verse 76 through 78. It's been handed to us as a free gift. The Lord just did it for us. I know it's an unspeakable gift. I know it's an amazing thing, but he did it. And when you find out about it, you get the life of Jesus. And when you got the life of Jesus, you got something good. Hallelujah. You know, you can be seated. We welcome all of you here tonight. Our dear friend and evangelist, Tim Hall. And sometimes I grapple for what words to use, whether I call him pastor or evangelist, brother, or just my dear friend, Tim. He's a blessing to us, been a blessing to us for many years. It's great to be in the company of the men of God. The reality of it is revivalists have always traveled like a cloud. They've always been very close to one another. And, you know, I was raised in a home. My dad is a revivalist, and, you know, he always basically tabernacled with the people in the Pentecostal movement, though he was ordained Southern Baptist. And we just kind of all stick together in the Holy Ghost. And it's a wonderful company to be in. We're glad you come and join a company here tonight with us. You know, Moses, he so wanted to see God. He so wanted to see Father in an unrestrained glory. And he had already had an experience with Father like nobody had had since Adam. I don't know. I would say, dare to say that Enoch had something superior to Hallelujah. He had something superior to Moses. But it's things that we can't talk about because he was caught away. And we'll have to learn about what all Enoch experienced, has been experienced for the past little over 5,000 years, sitting in the presence of the Lord in human form. That's what faith will get you into. Faith will get you translated. I mean, faith will cause you to please God. And faith is something that is a supernatural working of the Holy Ghost in our life. Father's given it to us once again. It's a gift. He's amazing. But anyway, Moses stood there after having such an amazing experience with Father. Said, I want to see you. I want to know who you are. And the Lord said, okay, I'm going to show you. And I'm going to reveal myself to you. I'm going to go ahead and let you see what others have been able to see. You know, first the Lord said, well, you know, look, nobody can see me and live. And Moses is like, I don't even care. It's fine. I'll die then. Just let me see you. Is basically what was his response. And the Lord passed by him and he said, here I am. I'm long-suffering and compassionate, merciful, full of goodness and truth. He's an amazing God. He's an amazing God. If you had one gift of the Spirit, or rather, forgive me, one activity of the fruit or manifestation of the Holy Ghost actively working in your life, overwhelming every part of your being, any one of them would be good, but goodness is a wonderful one. Can you imagine living all day in goodness? That's the life of God. What did God the Father show Moses? He showed him his life, and the fullness of that life was manifested in his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, and he's come and give to us this wonderful privilege to have the life of Jesus. There are a lot of people sitting in church, but I dare say there's few that have the life of Jesus. I'm just going to say it. A lot of people have called upon the name of the Lord, but I wonder really how many people have stepped in and begin to enjoy the very life of Christ, which is the life of God, full of long-suffering and compassion and mercy and goodness and truth. And so then Paul underscores the thing and says, looky here, the fruits of the Spirit, the characteristic of the Spirit, the evidence, you're going to know everybody by the fruits, you know. If you're born of the Spirit, you can't even come into the kingdom of God unless you're born by the Spirit. You're not a son of God unless you're walking in the Spirit, being led by the Spirit under his mastership. And those fruits are love and joy and peace and temperance and gentleness and goodness and meekness and all these wonderful, glorious things. Forgiveness is there, boldness is there, confidence is there. I know you only get basically 9 of them there in the list of Galatians chapter 5, 22, 23. But we pray tonight in the name of Jesus, you step into the abundant life. Quit struggling over it, just receive it. I mean, Papa gives it to anybody. He says, peace to those who are near and to those who are far off. Hallelujah. He says, peace to Mary, who is near, who the angel Gabriel said, you're getting ready to have a good thing happen to you. The power of God's going to overshadow you. Holy Ghost is going to come upon you. That holy thing that's going to be implanted into your womb. Hallelujah. We hope that a holy thing is implanted into your life. And if it's not, it happens tonight. That holy thing that God wants to implant into your life is the very life of Jesus, where Christ Jesus will abide in your heart by faith. Oh, we want everybody to come to know this transformation of life. It is the greatest power of repentance. Conversion is the greatest power of repentance. It's a radical event where the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you and changes you into an entirely new person. And according to the prophet Ezekiel, you get a new heart and a new spirit. A lot of people tell me they're saved, they're walking with God, and they know the Lord. And I ask one simple question. Do you have the same heart that you were born with? Do you have the same spirit that you were born with? And if the answer is yes and yes, I say, no, you've not been born again. Because the Lord will give you a new heart, and he'll give you a new spirit, and then he's like, stop. Hey, that'd be pretty good right there. That'd be great to start all over again, but we'd failed the same as before. We need to be taught. So he says, I'm going to fill you with my own spirit. The Spirit of the Lord. When you read in the Bible, in the Old Testament, everybody who had the Spirit of the Lord, my goodness, they were an elite group of people who did some amazing things. And in these last days, they that know their God shall do great exploits. And that's just who we are. We're a company of people that are doing great exploits. I know I start preaching and people get all overwhelmed. They go, wait a minute. I thought, when are you going to break out the crayons and the coloring books? I mean, because I'm, you know, it's like that's really seemingly what everybody wants. I'm believing raising up an army, a mighty Joel's army of people who know how to do great exploits, who know how to walk in the Holy Ghost, who know how to live in the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire, who know how not to offend God but to please him and walk in faith in every dimension of the life. And I hope that you're hungry for that. If you're not, I pray in the name of Jesus something happens to you tonight and you get hungry. Hallelujah. And you're like radical people around like me. Hallelujah. Somebody said to me one day, they said, well, you're just too intense to be a pastor. I said, just talk to God. I mean, talk to the Father. Talk to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit's the one who divides severally or individually to everyone according to his own will. I didn't ask to get into this. In fact, I said no when I was asked. I said, I'm not doing that. I'm not going to do that. And all the men of God were standing around me looking at me, you know, they were telling me I had to. They're saying, no, the Lord's called you. What are you doing? Well, I'm gonna go to medical school. And then you try to do that. It's like a dear friend of mine whom God has used in a powerful way to shake the earth in the 90s. Lord's using him today. He's telling me how he's just basically, you know, I'm done, I'm finished, put a fork in me, it's over, you know. I said, yeah, go ahead. That'll last about 30 days. Then you're going to be one bucket of tears, sobbing, walking around, crying out to God, oh, Lord, use me. Because you know what? When you've been captivated and apprehended by the power of the Holy Ghost, you can't do nothing else. We're ruined. And we pray tonight that you're going to get ruined. Hallelujah. We pray tonight that you'll be no good for the world. You won't work for the world. You won't work. Sin won't work for you. It won't bring you pleasure. It brings you grief and sorrow. The only thing that makes you happy is being in the presence of the living God, serving him and pleasing him. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, mighty God. Father, you're so wonderful. He gave us two of the, Papa's given everything to us. And, you know, Timotheus here actually took me, Carlos Anaconda, I love him so dearly. When a long time ago, he said, Mark, I want you to come. I'm going to start setting up crusades for you in Argentina. I want you to travel with me and be with me. And I went with Carlos for a while, but the Lord never really released me to do anything. He said, no, I'll put you in San Diego. You pastor. I said, well, Lord, nobody wants to listen to what I've got to say. He said, I don't care. You pastor. And so I'm doing that. But at any rate, Tim took me to Papua New Guinea with him, to lay Papua New Guinea. And it was just an amazing event. It's the first time I've ever been a part of a mass evangelism crusade like that. I mean, I've been with Carlos in mass evangelism crusade, and I said a few things. I've been with Rodney, said a few things in some big meetings and whatnot. But it's the first time he looked at me and said, it's Friday night, it's the big night, and it's your night. You're going to do this thing. And I'm like, okay, well, we're ready in Jesus' mighty name. Right. And he just gave me this kickoff. And so Papua New Guineans say,
they call Father, they call him Papa God. And long name, long Papa God, long name, long Pekinini, and long name, long the Holy Spirit. Amen. Cook him, Lord. Cook him up inside in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Yeah. Amen. And so Papa God's done so many things for us. He's, I love that. I mean, I love hearing the Papua New Guineans get up and begin to pray as they address Papa God. It's so beautiful, beautiful. But Papa God held nothing back from us. Father held nothing back from us. He gave us everything. He gave us everything dear and special to him, so sacred to him. He gave to us the word, his eternal word that was hidden in his bosom. He gave him to us. And he gave him to us as the only begotten son in such a way that he humbled him, even under the death of the cross. He didn't give him to us in the glory that he's always existed in and had for all eternity. He gave him to us in the robes of human flesh. It is amazing what God did for us in Jesus Christ. This is, it's beyond even being able to apprehend in the slightest little bit of form how he who is rich became poor for our sakes, that through his poverty we might be made rich, that he became the sacrifice for our sins, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. If he can become the sacrifice of sin for me, I'll surely become the righteousness of God for him. And he's made it all possible. And he didn't stop there. He didn't stop there. After having poured out the precious blood, after having poured out his life unto death for us, after having valued our life more important than his life, after having so desperately wanted us to be able to spend with him all the rest of eternity, to hang out with him, to be a part of his family, after that he did that and he went down into hell and he rose up the third day and ascended up on high, then Father and the Lord Jesus Christ both got together and sent us the most sacred and special. Father's emptying out heaven for you, man. He emptied out heaven for me. He emptied out heaven for the 2.6 billion people who never one time heard the name of Jesus. And tonight, I must be honest with you. I would rather be doing meetings with those people who've never heard than be here. But I know the Lord said, I got an assignment for you to be here, to raise up so many people to go there, because this is a last day and time and season in which Father has ordained for us to go everywhere and preach the gospel so that everybody can have a witness of this gospel of the kingdom, so that then the precious fruit of the earth that the husbandman hath long patience for might ultimately be evidenced in the earth in a glorious church, and then Father can come wrap it all up. It's going to take him about another 1,000 years to wrap it all up, but I mean, it's going to be a beautiful transition. And that's what we're looking for. It's what we're hastening to. We're running to that day. The two precious gifts are very precious to me. Father said, don't mess with the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, don't mess with the Holy Ghost. Jesus put it this way. He said, look, you know, I mean, Jesus is the greatest gift I can imagine to start with. Oh, I thank you, Father, for Jesus. I thank you, Jesus, for the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit revealed Jesus to me. Jesus revealed the Father to me, and praise God for that wonderful work of grace that's going on there. But Jesus said, don't mess with the Holy Ghost. Because if you mess with him, if you blaspheme against him, then it will not be forgiven you, not in this life and in the one to come. That's a pretty serious. That is to, there's a Hebrew terminology for that, and it's called karat. And karat means to be cut off without remedy. And there was a lot of reasons in the Old Testament that you could be cut off without remedy. There was no way for you to come back into the covenant. Tonight, we just want you to be patient with us as we do our very best in our understanding of how to function and flow in this wonderful and precious gift that God has given to us called the Holy Spirit. Be patient with us because he's wonderful. We do not want to grieve him in any way. He's easy. He loves us. He's so merciful. He knows how frail we are, stupid we are, how we just are stuck on our own impression of ourselves and what we think and what we believe and, you know, all of our doctrinal ideas that we're so astute to, even though we failed calculus. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And the word is far, far, far beyond multivariable equations and some other things I could say that you probably would not, most people don't even, few people on the face of the earth even know the terminology of in their area of physics. It can far superior to all the intellectual wisdoms of men and insights of men. And God's foolishness is wiser than the wisest thing that men have ever thought of. Tonight, just understand, we're going to move in the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost is going to reveal Jesus. And as he reveals Jesus, there's going to be the same ministry of Jesus Christ. And we're not going to stop. We're going to press in. We're going to participate with the Holy Ghost till we learn it all. because he's our teacher, he's our mentor, he's our guide. He's kind of bring us into the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus. Paul gives you two options in Ephesians chapter 4. He says in verse 12, you can come into the fullness of the measure of the maturity of the ministry of Jesus, or you can be a baby for the rest of your life, tossed to and fro by every activity and every deceiving work of men. One or two. I'm going for the first. I pray you join with me. Amen. We'll follow the Holy Ghost. We'll go for A. Amen. Tonight, and just I want to ask you to participate with the Father. I want you to also be a giver. Father wants to teach you how to be a giver so you can learn how to be a receiver. You can't learn how to be a receiver until you learn how to be a giver. As long as you hold on to things and you're selfish and stingy, it's a shield. It's closed you off from what God wants to supply to you. God in his mercy and his grace gave. And he gave to us beyond all that we could think or ask. And he gave knowing that he was going to have a great harvest. Somebody said that Father gave Jesus an expectation of nothing. I'm telling you, that's just not true. He's got the law set out. And when the seed was sown, Jesus said, lest the seed fall into the earth and die, it abideth alone. But when it dies, it brings forth much fruit. Hallelujah. That's us. Amen. Hallelujah. Say amen. That's me. And so, hallelujah. Tonight we're going to just obey the laws of God and do what Father did, and we're going to participate with him in the giving. And we're going to bless Tim Hall Ministries. And if you want to know more about, you're going to get some of you have not been to any of the meetings. How many of you, is this your first night in the meetings? Would you raise your hand, please? Could I just check it, look at you, because I can see some of you haven't been here. And so you can find out more about Tim Hall Ministries and on the web, and Tim's been going for a long time, and Father uses him in mass crusade evangelism with great signs and wonders. It's an amazing thing, all that the Lord does. The mute speak, the deaf hear, the blind see, and mostly what goes on over and again is the crippled walk, and this evangelist brings great joy to the places that the Spirit of the Lord sends him. Amen. And so I want everybody to just stand with me tonight so you can get to your wallet. It's hard to get to your wallet when you're sitting down. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And if you want to give by way of a check tonight, if you desire to give by way of a check, just give it to the Abiding Place Ministry. Tim Hall Ministries is a part of the Abiding Place Ministry. And so he's on my oversight board, and I'm on his ministry board. So if there's some exchange going on here, we take care of each other. Amen. What an honor, what a privilege to be on so many men of God's board. I am just blessed to be able to do that, serve that way. So when you're giving, just write out the Abiding Place Ministry, or just put APM on there. If you're so drunk in the Holy Ghost right now you can't write very well, just put APM, and the bank will cash it for us, and we'll give it to him. In fact, we'll put it directly into his bank account, in Jesus' name. Father, I thank you tonight for the miracles that are in the house. Father, I thank you for the miracle of supernatural provision. Hallelujah. That you cause whatever we sow into the kingdom to be multiplied so that we can continue to do more. For Lord, we know that you have placed this responsibility upon our shoulders to go everywhere preaching the gospel in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, in the uttermost parts of the earth, all at the same time. Hallelujah. And so, Father, we thank you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ tonight that faith will compel every person in this place to move in a realm of faith in the gift and in the giving, knowing that it is the act of worship that you desire in our life and that you're going to bless it, knowing, oh God, that there is an adjustment going on in their heart and life that is so, so needed so that they can learn how to receive more from you. And as we do, we just see you multiply everything concerning your goodness in our life and your grace in our life, both spiritually, physically, and materially. How many of you need a healing tonight? You need a healing. Anybody need a miracle tonight? There's miracles in the house. And you know what Father's going to do? He's going to give it to you free. He's going to give it to you. And you don't have to do anything. Just receive. Just receive. We want you to be able to receive. And you don't have to give to receive a miracle, but I just want you to recognize how rich God is towards us. And he wants us to participate with him in his nature because he's filled us with his life. And so we want to all learn. And this is a part of it. So we want you to just come and worship the Lord with your giving. Worship him with your giving. with your offering. Somebody said, I gave it the office. Okay, give it the church. Amen. Hallelujah. Tim, come in. Come. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hey, let me ask, was the microphone working fine on the web last night? Working fine. So the microphone's working fine. You don't need a lapel.
Well, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you so much.
Hallelujah.
Thank you so much. Oh, God is good. Someone say God is good.
He is. God is good.
God is good most of the time.
All the time.
All the time.
Continually.
All the time. Just tucking myself in. Don't worry. There we are. God is incredible. What a privilege to be a Christian. People think that you're a loser if you're a Christian. And it's true, we are losers if we become Christians. We lose sin. We lose guilt. We lose hell. We lose eternal judgment in fire being eaten by worms. And I'd have to say that I'm glad I lost that. I want to do something just for a couple of minutes, if I can. Can I indulge myself here, Reverend? All right. One group of people that I love in this church are the kids, the children. I actually had people leave our church a few years ago because we had miracle kids, and kids are goats, and so they left the church because we called it miracle kids, and they left. And I thought, spiritual giants walking out, spiritual giants. I thought, my goodness, people are weird. When God made people, he did make some weirdos. I've met some people that when God made them, I said, Lord, that person's quite weird. And I felt the Lord say, they really are. But now, snake, come here, please. Jake the snake. He's been doing a fair bit of work. Jake, he's sort of been recruited. You want to come back, Josiah? Okay. These two guys do a lot of work. I've actually, at this point of time, they are Bible carriers, water carriers. They are actually my assistants. So we don't want to make them feel like they are more important than the other kids. I've just elected them for this job. They've just been employed by me. I pay them in drawings. So what I want is, how many children here under the age of whatever would like a drawing tonight? Oh gosh, we better. All right, all the smaller ones first. We're going to start on 0 to 10. If you're 0 to 10, come down here. We've got to see 0 to 10. In Aussie, that's 0. All right, we'll get a count. What's your counting like, Josiah? All right, come on down, kids. What have we got? 1. We've got Abby. My old mate Brian, Maddie. Isabella, of course. I knew you'd be down, Isabella. And my middle mate, what is it? Ezekiel, exactly, Ezekiel. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. How many drawings have I got? Let's get a count here, guys. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Philip Duck, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Oh, come on, Brooke. There's 16 there, are there? What about these little kids at the back? Oh, Brooke, come on down, both of you. We're going to make the drawings multiply. All right. Now, don't go away, because I'm going to pray for you after this. Who would like a crocodile quickly? Crocodile? Brian, give that to Brian, please. Get ready to distribute, brothers. I've got a reasonably fat cow. Who would like that? Who'd like the fat cow quickly? The fat cow. The boy at the back, fat cow. We've got a loony duck with one crook eye. Right, hand that one out, please, Josiah. You wanted a flying rat, didn't you? Daryl, the flying rat. That's yours, I believe. What did you want, the snake?
A goofy looking giraffe. Who'd like that, please? Yes, give that to one of the boys. Quickly, Josiah, concentrate, brother. Kangaroo. Who'd like a kangaroo?
Yeah, what many people don't realize is that, among other things, Tim's an amazing artist.
These are quick. These are not exactly going to make huge money. I have signed them, though. A snake with a moustache, glasses, and a hat, and one ear to keep his glasses on. Who would like that rattlesnake, please? Did you want a snake? Oh, that's yours. You can have the snake. That's your snake. Philip the Fat Duck. Who'd like Philip the Fat Duck? Hand that one out quickly. It's an elephant. Extremely fat dog. Super chicken. Little brother down here, super chicken. Clint Stork with football boots. Clint Stork. Would you hand that at one of you? Jake, snake. Hand that one out, please. Cow munching straw. That's it, brother. Really silly looking pig that looks like it's been through a famine. Right, you haven't got one, Abby. Would you like the pig? Give it to Abby there, snake. A really retarded cat. Who's missed out? Who's missed out on a drawing? All right, after the meeting, I do have a frog with an Australian hat. All right, brother at the back with the eyes poking out of his head, nearly a foot, come up here quickly. No, the one with the hat, the blue, brother blue. Looking, yes. No, you've got one. Well, who hasn't got one? Come up here, Ezekiel, and you get the frog. It's quite a good one. You haven't got one. Who hasn't got one? Now, I counted very well there, I thought.
It's the old age.
All right, if you've missed out, immediately after the meeting, I may draw while I'm preaching. How many kids have not got a drawing? All right. Thanks, Brooke. You'll get your drawing after the meeting. In the meantime, line up here, because I want to pray for you. Would you just lead them down there? Line them up, please, boys. You've got a job here, another task.
Gently. I feel like the Pied Piper. And close your eyes, kids. Just close your eyes. You know, the Spirit of the Lord is here. I know you missed out, Brooke. I know you missed out. Just let God touch you. You are special kids. Don't drop your drawing. That's a beautiful fit, that coat. It's a lovely fit. Looks really nice. That's your dad's. Where's Dad? Is he back there? Where's Dad? Where are you, Dad? Back there somewhere. He's left. Jesus. Touch with power right now. Right now. That's it. Power from heaven on every one of these young people. Jesus' name. Power from heaven. That's it. Take it all. Take it all. Hello. What's her name?
Francesca.
Jesus. Let the power of God go right through her. There you go. Now, filled with the Holy Ghost, Francesca. Is that nice? Have some more. Brooke, you missed out on a drawing, but there's the anointing. Jesus. Touch this young man, Father. Let power go right through his body. Thank you, Lord. Jesus. Have some more, Francesca. Isn't that wonderful? Just nice and filled. Hello, Abby. You're very special. You've got the sweetest little face. Touch your Lord. Just let the power of God go right through Abby. Touch your Lord. Thank you for her. My old friend Brian. Let the anointing come on Brian tonight. There you go, Brian. Maddie, my mate. God use you two fellas. God use you. Keep his hand on you. Strongly. What's your name, champion?
Wesley.
Let me see your drawing. Which one did you get? Oh, you got the fat duck. Is that all right? Touch Wesley tonight, Father. Touch him. Touch Wesley, Father. Touch him.
touch him.
Well, look who it isn't.
I know. Jesus, just touch her right now. Touch her. Touch her. Let the power of God just fill her up. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you.
Hello. Did you get the super chicken? Well done. Jeez. Oh. What did you get? The extremely fat dog. Touch. What did you get? Nothing. After the meeting. Jesus. Frog, well done. How are you anyway, handsome? Have you got a twin brother? You got a cat down there. Touch them, Lord. Touch them. Touch them. Just bless them. Hello. How'd you get flying rat? How'd you get that one? Just swap. It's got the flying rat. Jesus. What'd you get, snake? Oh, yours, you got the snake. Done a tremendous job this week. Are you exhausted? Touch him, Lord. Josiah, you've worked hard, haven't you, mate? You've carried more water this week. Those biceps are swelling out of control with the work you've done this week. It's been extraordinary. Touch him, Father. Hello. Did you get a drawing? What did you get? Oh, the cat. Well done. Is he yours? Isn't he exceptionally handsome?
Yeah.
Is this another grand?
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Jesus, just touch this little one. Touched. What's his name?
John Luke.
Oh, John Luke. Touch John Luke tonight. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, that's your cousin, is it? Yeah, you got cousins everywhere, hundreds of them. Bless your kids. You can go back, if you can hop up and sneak back to your seat now. Let's give the kids a clap. Over the years, oh, that knee, it's getting better. A lot of years of Aussie rules football. Got injured a few times, also inflicted some injuries. Sure, there's some old guys my age getting around going, I remember when that guy ran into me. Something about kids, children, and over the years traveling and preaching, in the early days we used to stay in people's homes, and I used to draw cartoons for the kids and get out and play cricket and football with them, and I don't know how many got the baptism of the Spirit and got touched by God in those meetings, and they come up now and they're married people with kids, and they come up and they show me, they said, you did all these drawings in 1 week. And it's funny, I feel like I get a really weird, I said to Rob before, I said, Rob, the sad, worrying thing is that these animals are in me. And I didn't bring any books over these few days, but if anyone would like to order one of my books on the giant killers, there are those that have said, look, can I get one of the books? If you'd like one, I could leave one here for you for Sunday. I can bring some over here and leave them at the church on Sunday. I had a number of people asking if they could get the book, The Giant Killers. It's the book I've written about bringing down the giants that you face in your life. Are there any people that have been wanting that? If you do, if you want a copy of the book, would you see the Geneva Convention and just give her your name and I will leave those books here so that you can get them on Sunday. Is that okay? We'll get it. You can get them, pick them up here. And they're $20. They're worth a lot more. I would rate them worth 21. But you can have them for 20. It's been a joy to be here this week, and God does save the best to last. We are going to have a great night tonight. The Spirit of the Lord is already wonderful here. But I really think that God's going to do something special tonight. How many believe something is going to happen in the house tonight? And these have been good days. I've been blessed. I enjoy sitting with Pastor Mark. He is the greatest inspiration to me in the Word of anybody I know in the world. I actually don't know anyone in the world, and I travel all over the world through some of the biggest churches in the world. I preach in churches that are huge, mega churches of 30,000, 40,000, and I don't know one man of God or woman of God anywhere in the world that comes close to Pastor Mark. And I mean that. I always think I'm going okay. Then I sit down with him, and then I've got to go back to the drawing board, go home, and I feel like his knowledge of the Word is university while I'm still trying to pass finger painting one. But so we have a great time together, and I've enjoyed being in the home, enjoyed it. I've had just a terrific time. And yeah, I want to thank you, Pastor Mark, Pastor Ann, for just looking after me so well and the family. I just love being with the Spitsbergens. It's a great name, isn't it? Something like a hamburger and spitting combined. It's just a good name. It's a funny name. You could have a spit hamburger. I don't know. It's a funny name. People have funny names. Mine is just Tim Hall. It's actually Timothy Gordon Stewart Hall. It's not a bad name. I was actually called Gordon. I was named after my grandfather, whose name was Tom. I was actually named after an uncle called Gordon, but my grandfather, whose name was Tom, had a number of guys named after him, but they always called him Tim, but they hadn't called anyone Tim after Tom, because even though they called him Tim, his name was Tom, and they hadn't named anyone Tim after Tom, but they called me Gordon, and they took me in there 6 weeks old I was, and I went in there just before he died, and they thought, someone's got to have the name Tim. So I was Gordon, so they named me Tim after Tom, and it's been confusing. So all I was ever called was Tim, and so I added it for $2. I paid $2 to add it to the front of the name, and I went from Gordon Stewart Hall to Timothy Gordon Stewart Hall when I was 27, which is approximately 39 years ago that I officially became Tim Hall, but I've always been called Tim Hall, even though my name was Gordon, named Tim after Uncle Tom. My grandfather Tom, who people called Tim. And so as a child, there was confusion, and that explains a lot of my personality. I explained a little bit about some of my aunties, my early church life. It was an unusual life as a child. On Sundays, we would go for a drive. We had an exciting life. We had no radio, we had no television, we didn't have to. I didn't have television until I was a teenager. I see the kids today with the little things, and they're running along. They're going up trees and down tunnels and jumping and doing that. In this thing, we used to actually do it. We used to actually climb trees. Now, I know that's a strange thing for many of the young people today. For excitement, my dad would take me to the railway station, and we would stand on the bridge, and the train would come under and cover us in smoke and steam, and that was the highlight of my week. And then on Sunday, to add to the fox stories, Dad would say, we're going for a drive, so we would get in the Hillman Minx. 10 horsepower of English garbage. A Hillman Minx. And we would drive to Fox's Hangout. I'm sure people watching on the internet are thrilled about this, and I am going to preach the word, but we would drive to Fox's Hangout, where the foxes that were shot by the farmers were hung in a tree. And we would go out and see all the dead foxes and smell the dead foxes, walk around, and Dad's saying, look at all the dead foxes. And we go, wow, that's a lot of dead foxes. And Dad can say, can you smell them? I said, yes, there is a pungent aroma going forth into my nostril region, and I'm inhaling it into my lungs, the odor of death. And we would drive home. And then my auntie would embrace me with that other fox, the story I told you with Auntie Eva. And I actually used to have nightmares of foxes chasing me. And so when I was on the farm years ago, I became a very skilled fox shooter. I shot 6 foxes one night, and every one of them was like revenge. Revenge for Auntie Eva. And Fox's Hangout. But anyway, that's got nothing to do with anything. So I'd like you to turn, please, to the book of Luke. If you're an Irishman, I would say to you tonight, I'd like you to turn in your Bible to the book of Luke.
in the book of Luke and have a little look around. It'll be wonderful to be. But I'm not Irish, so I suggest we turn to the book of Luke. And I want to talk about keys to the miraculous. Keys to getting healed tonight. Keys to walking in healing power. Father, would you anoint your word now with strength and authority? I pray that your word tonight would be quick and sharp and active and alive. And let there be miracles here tonight. In Jesus' name. Let there be miracles here. Miracles at home. In the name of Jesus. The book of Luke chapter 5. Every one of the miracles in the Gospels have little keys to divine healing. I've pulled them all apart. I've looked at all the key words and I've tried to find every key that I can grab a hold of that helped to unlock the area of the miraculous. I suggest what I used to do was take an old Bible that was a bit of an old discarded Bible, and I would cut out that particular piece of scripture, and if it was in two of the Gospels, I would cut it out of the different Gospels and stick it onto one big page. Then I'd go through and dismantle it and find all the key words, underline them, and find out what they said in the Greek language and what was variation, seeming variation, and yet adding another dimension to the miracle, and pull them apart and write all my notes, and eventually from that begin to come up with thoughts and then a sermon and then a series, and every one of them is unique. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word. And we need to study the Word of God. I was in a Bible college in England, and I said to them, I said, look, we're talking about healing. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God, so I want you to do something. Shut your Bible. I said, I'm going to go around this room, and I want every person to give me one scripture on divine healing that you know by heart. Share it with us, with the class, and we'll put them up here on the board, because how can we lead people to be divinely healed if we do not know what the Word of God says on the subject? If we don't know what it says, how on earth are we going to convince the world? And I started up and said, have you got a scripture for me? And they gave me something. Yourself? Can you come back to me, please? Sister, come back to me. Next one. I went right around the room. I reckon if I was lucky to have had, it's the second year of a college in England, of a good church, big church, and I reckon I was lucky to get 6 or 8 scriptures before they started to run out and scratch their heads. We need to be able to open this word up and start working our way through from Exodus 15, 26, I'm the Lord that healeth thee, on into Deuteronomy 7, on into scripture after scripture, through the miracles of one of 2 Kings, the first few chapters of 2 Kings. We need to dig those miracles out, the miracles of the great prophets Elijah and Elisha in both 1 and 2 Kings. We need to go on into the miracles that occurred. Go into Psalm 103, Psalm 107, and so on through Isaiah 53, Isaiah 52, 53, and on through the scriptures, Matthew 8, 16, 17, on into 1 Peter 2, 24, and all the miracles, all the different keys to the miraculous in the Gospels, and we need to get them so that we don't just read them, but we absorb them, and they begin to become life. This word, too often, instead of really digesting it and letting it get in there, if we have a good steak, it's because a bullock has had a good feed of grass and digested it until that thing becomes steak. And we've got to take the Word of God and chew it and eat it. The Bible says it's life to them that find it, and you don't find it unless you look for it. You don't find it unless you seek it. And God's made it that this word, if you start to hunger into it and chew below the surface and dig into it, it comes alive. It sprouts. We sat down today and talked about one word from the book of Hebrews. Did we talk about it for 30 or 40 minutes? Open it up, maybe not that long, but we spent ages, page after page, going through the understanding of one word that that was bringing one scripture to life. So let's have a look here at this scripture. The Bible says in verse 15, so much the more went there a fame. That word fame is a roaring. Everybody was talking about Jesus. There was a roaring abroad. Everybody. Everyone was talking about this man that in the white robe carrying this immense anointing. And the Bible says, and great multitudes, massive crowds, came together for two reasons, to hear and to be healed. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. They came to hear what he says, and they came with an expectation to be healed. And I think when we come to church, we ought to come to hear the word and then to receive the demonstration of his power. To hear and to be healed. So much today in the body of Christ is flowery sermons and good sermons and sermons about all manner of things with very little demonstration. This gospel is a gospel of demonstration. The Apostle Paul, writing in Romans 12, Romans 15, he says, from Illyricum down to Jerusalem, I have fully preached the gospel with signs, wonders, and miracles. Books alive. As we share it, that extraordinary thing called faith begins to rise on the inner man. The Bible says that Jesus did what he normally did, and he withdrew himself away into the presence of the Father, into the wilderness, and he prayed. That was his habit. He'd get away from the multitudes, go into the mountains, touch God, just get with the Father, just let his whole being be built up and strengthened by the intimacy of his relationship. Bible says it came to pass on a certain day. Someone says certain day. As he was teaching, as he was sharing the word, that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town of Galilee, Judea, and Jerusalem. Here's this great crowd that's come, and they're sitting in what is Peter's house in Capernaum. They're sitting in the house, probably a big room. Peter would have had money when he got out of his fishing business and moved from Bethsaida up to Capernaum. He probably bought a decent-sized house. And Jesus almost certainly stayed in that place and traveled out from Peter's home. I think that's a fair... You're happy with that, Reverend? I think he's happy with that. If not, repair it Sunday. The Bible says they're in the house. In fact, it says it was noised that he was in the house. It was noised that he was in the house. It's the greatest thing that can happen to a church is that the word goes everywhere. God's in the house. Greatest thing is not they have great programs. They've got a tremendous children's playground. They give away goldfish at Sunday school. God's in the house. God's in the house. Greatest thing tonight is God in the house. Not the visiting speaker, God. The Bible says they'd come out of every town of Galilee. Pharisees, doctors of the law, Sadducees, sitting there, listening to every word. Some of them had come out of curiosity. We have an idea that the Pharisees were always against him. Well, the truth is that a very large number of Pharisees actually became Christians. A large number through the scriptures became obedient to the faith. The Sadducees, not so. The Pharisees were much easier to win to Christ than the Sadducees. The Pharisees were a very bit full of law, but they believed in the supernatural. The Sadducees were your liberals, plenty of money, and they really had a fairly liberal gospel. But it was the Pharisees that were turning. Who knows how many of these got saved, but they were sitting there listening to him, trying to work out
what good thing has come out of Bethlehem? I think they, out of Nazareth, they're trying to work out who he was, where he fitted. Who was he? Who is this man that is shaking everything where he goes? We'll listen to him. And Jesus is teaching them in the house. As he's teaching them, something is happening. As the word is going out, the Bible says this, and the power of the Lord was present to heal him. Now, if you look in your Bible there, it says that the power of the Lord was present. That's in italics. It's not there. And the power of the Lord was to heal them. God was there to heal them. They were sitting in judgment, curiosity, wondering. And here's this extraordinary piece of scripture. And the power of the Lord was there to heal them. Despite their attitude, the grace of God was there if they would just want to receive it. The power of God was there if they were just willing to humble themselves and accept him, his miracle power was there. But the extraordinary thing is that none of them were healed. I know that because I've read on. The only person who got healed that day was a guy some distance away who made a decision that if he was carried there on a bed and lowered down through the roof, that he knew that if he could get into the presence of Jesus, he would be healed. He was the only one that got healed that day. No one else got healed. And the reason for that, I read it in verse 26, it says, and they were all amazed, and they glorified God and were filled with fear, saying, we have seen strange things today. And that word strange in the Greek language is paradoxa, which literally, paradoxia, which means something astonishing or something unexpected. We have seen something astonishing and unexpected. They had no expectation. One of the biggest things missing in the body of Christ today is a holy expectation. We can come to church with an expectation at a certain level. We can come tonight and say, well, I reckon tonight I'll just get a good touch, maybe get the joy of the Lord on me, and that'll be a good night. But maybe God wants you to step out a little further and begin to say, I have an expectation that the long-term sickness that I've had in my body is about to go. I have an expectation that tonight is going to go to a level and I'm going to be touched in a way I've never been touched before. We come into meetings with a preconceived idea. I used to go to church, to the first church of the frigid air where many are cold and a few are frozen. And I knew exactly what would happen. We would sing four hymns from the thing up on the board. I would look around all the hats. We would have a short sermon from somewhere. And then we would have the benediction. May God watch between you and me while we're absent one from another. Ah, amen. And I'd go, you beauty, we're going home. That was church. Go home, get changed. Go out and kick the football. You're ready. You had your expectation the whole day. You knew. And that's the problem, that even in Pentecostal churches, you can pretty much know what will happen in most churches, meeting after meeting. You know how long worship will probably go? Announcements, church news, sermon, out by such and such, gone home. Every week. The kingdom of God is a kingdom of expectation.
We ought to expect that. See, we may even have an expectation of how tonight is going to go. What he's going to do. My prayer is tonight that God will overrule anyone's expectation, including mine. I don't want to have an expectation. One of those powerful things we talked about it the other night. We talked about watching that flat water, waiting for something to stir. The world's waiting in expectation that something's going to happen. You might have come here tonight as a guest and you've got no idea what to expect tonight. You've heard stories. That's that church where strange things happen. Just watch they don't throw something on you, or watch that you don't catch something. Expectation's a powerful thing. Benny Hinn's meetings are loaded with expectation. You think about a Benny Hinn meeting, or in the old days, a Catherine Kuhlman meeting, or a Bonnke meeting. There's a lady, let's take a hypothetical story, she lives, say, in San Diego, and there's going to be a big Benny Hinn crusade occurring in San Francisco. But she hasn't got the money to get there, so she begins to believe God. And she starts to pray, God, would you give me the money? I'll know it's your will. And I know it. I'm just believing you'll get the money. God, I believe that you've set out for me to go. And she starts believing God, puts a few hints out, and then believing and praying, the odd hint here and there. But she gets her money. And she says, I'm going to pray and fast. I'm going to have my miracle. And I've decided to fast. And I'm going to spend 10 days praying and fasting for my miracle. And she talks to a group of her friends. Let's say there's 10. And she says, would you fast and pray with me? And let's say, hypothetically, 10 of them agree. Nine friends and her all agree that they're going to fast 10 days and commit 3 hours a day to prayer. They're going to do that for 10 days. So you now got 10 people praying 3 hours a day for 10 days. You do the maths on that, and then you've got all those days of fasting. So you've got 10 people fasting 10 days, which is 100 days. 100 days? Is it? Yeah, 10 lots of 10. Yeah, my maths is pretty good. So you've now got 100 days of fasting, intense prayer, backing one person. But she gets on the bus here, and there are 40, let's just get a round figure, 50 on the bus. And they're all backed by that much, by 100 days. And so the math starts to work out. You've got 40 people on the bus, all backed by another 10, so that's 400. Lots of 10 days of fasting. That's 4,000 days of fasting and prayer backing one bus. And as they're going, up on the screen comes miracle after miracle after miracle all the way to San Francisco. And they're getting excited and they're singing, how great thou art, and looking at the miracles and seeing people out of wheelchairs, and their faith is rising on that bus. And when they arrive there, they join another 400 buses that have come. And each of those buses is backed by, and I've lost track, but you're now getting into many thousands of days of prayer and fasting and expectation and declaration of people saying, I know you're going to be healed. And people saying, when I get to the meeting, I know. And then the people stream in that have been praying and have traveled distance by car, and they've been believing God, and they've been watching the program for years until faith has just risen in their heart, so that as they begin to sing, the anointing that's in that building is so intense that just standing in that place, the expectation of thousands of days of prayer and fasting is so strong in that building that just to begin to worship and touch God, people are reaching out. The Holy Ghost is so excited about the desperate hunger that's there that he cannot wait to just jump onto people in power. So as they're worshiping God, the expectation is now rising, rising, because they realize that we're moving to a point where any minute now something is going to break out of here and there are going to be remarkable miracles. Expectation. Most people come to church, don't expect anything. Maybe a touch from God, whatever. But if we can begin to talk miracles, speak miracles, intensely pray for miracles, pray for the manifestation of the power of God, pray for an overwhelming anointing of the Spirit every meeting, unite together and say, I don't know, but I feel that we're stepping into a day of extreme miracles, that we're stepping into a place. I'm speaking it all the time. I've been telling people today on the phone to England and Australia, something is happening in America. America is opening up to a move of power that I believe is quite extraordinary and quite unprecedented. These guys had no expectation. They were sitting under the word with the King of Glory preaching, with the power of the Lord present to heal them, but no expectation. They went away and they said, amazed and saying, we have seen amazing, unexpected things today. The power of the Lord was present, but they didn't get healed. It's possible to sit in a meeting where the power of God's like a fire and not get your miracle. There's ingredients that go with the presence of God. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. James 2:26 says, without faith without works is dead. As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without an accompanying action is dead, being itself alone. Faith always has an accompanying action. If we pray for your arm, Jesus prayed for someone's arm that was withered, he would simply say, stretch it out and do something you couldn't do. Stretch it! Through the Bible, the apostles didn't say, oh, Jesus, please, would you come and touch this one? Oh, God, we implore you. No, at the gate, beautiful. Peter looked at the guy and he said, silver and gold have I none, but the thing that I've got right now, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up on your feet. This business of, oh God, if it be your will, oh God, if it be thy sovereign will to touch this dear one, please step in right now. Oh, obviously it wasn't. If you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you'll say to this mountain, get up and move into the sea. And if you doubt not, but you believe that what you say is going to come to pass, you'll have whatsoever you say. Have the God kind of faith. It says, have faith in God, but really it goes further than that. It says, have God faith in the Greek. Have God faith. Have the God faith. Speak to the mountain. He says, you speak to the mountain, the same thing will happen. When Jesus was in the boat and the wind and the waves were sinking the boat, he stood up on the front and he said, be still. And they said, what manner of man is this that even the wind and the waves obey him? But he said to them, oh, ye of little faith, why'd you doubt? Later on, he went across to the same area. He was having a revival over there. And he sent them alone, and they were rowing. And the Bible says it was torturous. They were into the breeze, and the thing was probably going nowhere, and their hands were blistering, and they were rowing and rowing and rowing. And Jesus came walking past, and the Bible says he would have walked right past them. And I said, why did you send them over, Lord? Why'd you send them over there when they had to row into that breeze and then you were going to walk past them? Fortunately, Peter spotted the Lord and said, it's the Lord. They said, no, it's a ghost. He said, no, it's Jesus. He said, Jesus, if that's you, Lord, tell me to come. And then he heard a terrible thing. Come! Peter had been a fisherman for a long time and he recognized that as a fisherman, if you stand on water, it doesn't hold you. And he heard, come! And he got out of the boat and he walked on the water and Jesus got in the boat and they were immediately to the other side. But I said, God, how come you let him row into that breeze? And I felt the Lord say,
I showed them the first time how to still a big storm, and they just had a nice little one to still. Just gave them a little one to try on. Just a strong breeze, torturous breeze. He was looking and going, when is someone going to stand up at the front of that boat? When is Peter, someone going to get up on that boat? Haven't I been around with them long enough that someone learnt last time that you stand up and you point to the wind and you point to the waves and say, be still. Fortunately, Peter spotted him. Otherwise, they might still be rowing. Faith has an action. Faith has an action. It always does. Right through the scriptures. God would speak, someone would act. Do this. Go wash in the pool of Siloam. Go show yourself to the priest. Stretch forth your hand. Stand up. Get up and walk. Take up your bed. Do something. Here was a guy on the other side of town. Paralyzed. The Bible in the Greek speaks of the fact that he'd had a stroke or something, and the word there speaks of him being paralyzed on one side. Whether he had an accident, we don't know much about him except he had some friends. And he said, guys, I can't get over there. I could hop, but I'm not really, it's a long way to hop. Can you carry me across? And they put him on the bed and carried him. When he got over there, they couldn't get in. They could find no way in because of the multitude. But the scripture says that they didn't give up, but they sought means. And sometimes you come to that dead end, and that's when you get before God and you seek means. When everything says you can't do it, you get before God and you seek means to get in. You come to a place where you're wanting to buy a home, but everything's going wrong with your finances, and you don't know which way to turn, the banks, everything's wrong. You seek means. You get on your face with God and say, with men these things are impossible. I've got a word from you. I'm seeking means. Seeking a way. God has a way. God has a way to break in for your family. God has a way to break in your business. God has a way to take your business from something that is just battling along to something that is extraordinary. God has a way. You say, God, is this how you want me to be? Do you want me to... There's something so much bigger. But, oh, God, it seems that everything's against it. He says, seek means. Seek my face. And one of the bright sparks said, I know, let's get on the roof. And they jumped across a few houses. There's a big gap. And they said to him, we're going to have to jump across there onto the next house. This is me imagining it. And I picture him saying, yeah, go ahead. If you drop me, I can't get much worse hurt than I am. They got onto the roof. And there was a ceiling. See, people have the idea that faith is so passive that you just... Oh, well, if it doesn't happen, Jesus doesn't love me. Nobody loves me. Everybody hates me. I'm going to go and eat worms. Haven't you? Do you sing that? You do that here? Nobody loves me. Everybody hates me. So I'll eat some worms. Big, fat, juicy ones. Little, long, thin, slimy ones. Oh, hey, they wriggle and squirm. Is that an American song or just an Aussie song? You know it? It's powerful, powerful. They get up on the roof, there's a ceiling. Jesus is so close, and yet there's something to break through. And too many Christians are so close to their miracle. They're on the edge of it. Don't give up on the edge of a miracle. I don't know the rest, but it's a good line. Jesus is down there. They're up on the roof. Ah, we want our result. But the guy says, I've just got to get into the presence of Jesus. What are we going to do? And another guy says, that's great, because I just happened to bring a pneumatic drill with me. Another one says, yes, and I've got a couple of serious implements here. Another guy's got a pick, another one with a shovel.
There's only four of them, but they've carried him plus all their equipment. And a very early truck that was a very early one. Flintstone style with a. And they start chopping the roof down. Sometimes in prayer, let me tell you, sometimes in prayer, you come to a point where the only thing left is a savage, ferocious, desperate time to press into God and rebuke and bind every hellish thing that makes itself a ceiling and start to take a stand. Faith is the hypostasis, the standing under of things confidently and certainly expected. There's a time sometimes when everything's against you, when everything's going wrong and everything just isn't working, but you know that there's something there if you can. That's when you just, in the words of Clint Eastwood, you just get dog darn mean. Dog, I don't know if that's swear. It's not swearing. Is it dog darn? Dog darn mean. They start to break in. You just got to get dog darn mean. I've learned a lot from Clint. The gospel according to Clint. I know for my daughter and family and stuff, there's a time when you just grit your teeth. You see, too many Christians are ferocious with people, they're gentle as doves with the devil, and ferocious with people. They got it all wrong. They blast people, and in the spirit realm, they've got about as switched on as Tiny Tim tiptoeing through the tulips. Do you remember him? Not singing it. You remember, don't you? Tiptoe in the morning. Through the tulips, that's where I'll be. Tiptoe in the morning with me. Tiptoe. It's a great song. A one-hit wonder, Tiny Tim. Good name, Lunatic. You know, as Christians, people have the idea that we're sort of just insipid people that just, we just have our Bible and we're just nice, you know, hallelujah, yes. I'm a Christian and I go to church. And, you know, if I see an ant, I walk around it. And I'm very politically correct. Just never upset about anything. Just get along and just like Disneyland, I throw flowers and little birds. We ought to be nice people. Nice, loving people that are caring. But I tell you, if we're going to do something for God, down in here, we've got to be gladiatorial. We have to be, we've got to be ferocious in the spirit. I get out, when I get out in the mountains, I seek God with just from sunrise to sunset, cry out in the spirit, crying out, God, Jesus, your anointing, power of your, God, God. So hungry. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom suffers violence, and violent men and violent women lay hold of it and seize it. I think the word is catalambano. They seize and grip hold of it. You say, surely we have bold access. Yes, we do, but you've got everything on this planet that'll fight you and keep you out of the throne room. You've got every circumstance of life trying to keep you out of the prayer closet. Trying to keep you from dynamic, powerful, aggressive, purposeful, laser-like prayer that breaks through in the heavenlies. sloppy Christianity will bore you to death, leave you with no results. God's looking for warriors in the spirit. You come to that ceiling, and that thing's there, but you can hear the voice of Jesus, and you go, Lord, nothing can separate me from the love of God. There's no such thing as a brazen heaven. Devil, someone's moving here today, and it's not me. I want to say to you, devil, you're trying to set up a ceiling. We're going to come through. And if you don't get out of the road, you're going to hurt very badly. There's a ferocity. I'm not that fond of the word nice. I'm nice. I'm like an old granddad. But in the spirit, I'm as mean as a junkyard dog. I love Jesus with all my heart, but when it comes to the point where you're going to preach in Pakistan or Myanmar or next year to where are we going? Yeah, we just had an invitation to Cyprus and some other place and some other crazy wonderful place where then you go into prayer and you begin to say, my God, I want to go in there in the absolute fullness of the Holy Ghost. I don't want to go in there just with John 3:16. Father, I want to go in armed to the teeth. The Bible says, put on the whole armor of God. Clothe yourself in duo. Put on a clothing of the whole armor, the panoplia, from two Greek words, pass and hoplon. Pass all, hoplon weaponry. Put on the entire weaponry of a fully armed Roman legionnaire. If I preach a bit long, we're okay. I tell you what, if you sit down and watch a movie, I'd hate it if, you know, you're watching a movie, 30 minutes, she's over. I don't mind preaching 30 minutes. Some places it's perfect. You guys love the Word of God. But there's a tenacity. I'm talking to you about a holy ferocity in the spirit. A seizing hold. The Bible uses these strong words. Kata lambano, kata down, lambano to seize. Seizing down and gripping hold. Is that something that says, I don't believe in letting go? Jacob says, as he's wrestling with the angel says, let me go. He says, I won't let you go till you bless me. I will not let you go. So the angel touches his leg and a hamstring's gone or in his thigh and the strongest muscle area of his leg doesn't work. You can't wrestle when that leg's gone. Now he is still wrestling, but all the weight, the angel's bearing all the weight, who I believe was Jesus in the Old Testament. Now his dependence in his own strength is gone. He's wrestling, but he realizes the one he's wrestling with is in control, but he won't let go, but he's aware. The angel says, what's your name? He says, it's Jacob the supplanter, or the one that takes hold. He says, no more will you be called Jacob the supplanter, but Israel, for you are a prince with God, and you have prevailed, and now you have power with God and power with men. Something happens when we won't stop at that ceiling, but we decide in God that there's something that we want. There's something in God that's there for. There's something that God wants us to take hold of. I tell you, if I preach anything this week, and you want to know me, right now, this is who I am. If I've shared anything out of my heart this week, this is me. How big a thing do we want to touch with God? How hungry are we to shape the nations? How desperate are we to break into something? Christians waffle around year after year after year. Scripture says we've been around this mountain too long. A Christian's here tonight. And you know in your heart you've been around this mountain a long time. And you know it's time to climb to another dimension. You know it is. You know it's time to break into something in God that you've never dreamed before. You know it's time to break into a realm in the Holy Ghost. You've been in a good place, but you've been there a long time. And God's saying, how hungry are you for the next phase? I mean, I'm preaching a healing sermon tonight, and it's a long one. It's our last night tonight, so you're not getting a sermon, you're getting a series. In fact, by the time the night's over, it'll be a book. All the greats of history that did something for God knew how to bust that ceiling. What's that ceiling that's against you? Is there one? Is there one? What's that ceiling that you've got to break? What's that ceiling that you've got to hack your way through in prayer and dare to God? Bust through it. They dug a hole in the roof. I don't know what Peter thought, but they lowered him down before Jesus. As they lowered him down, the Bible says Jesus, seeing their faith. Jesus, seeing their faith. Faith can be seen because it's active. Faith without an accompanying action is dead. They could have stayed up on the roof forever. But they made a step, and as they acted their faith, Jesus, seeing their faith, said, man, that's a word to me tonight. That's a word to me tonight. You can look at that ceiling, or you can bust it tenaciously, speaking to it. You're very quiet. I'm going to finish this off. The Bible says, behold, men brought into bed a man which was taken with a palsy. And they sought means, or they sought to bring him in and lay before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in because of the multitude, they went upon the housetop and let him down through the tiling with his couch in the midst before Jesus. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto him, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. Two things are happening. Power of God's present to heal. And these guys have acted their faith. And no one's healed yet. This guy's acted his faith. But now he's waiting for a point of contact. And Jesus said, sir, your sins are forgiven you. It's an incredible statement that he's making, not to him, but to those around. He's saying, who can forgive sins? They're asking who he is, and he's saying, I'm the one that can forgive your sins. They would consider that to be unbelievably blasphemous. Either he's the Son of God or he's a total blasphemer at this point. And then he looked at them. I imagine he looked at them from person to person, and perceiving what they're thinking. He says, all right, which is easier? Which one tells you more that I'm the divine Son of God? Your sins are forgiven? Get up off the floor and walk. Which one tells you more clearly who I am? But he says, but that you might know that the Son of Man truly does have power on earth to forgive sins. He said to the man, stand up on your feet. And immediately the man stood up. The action of faith. was in a meeting one night. A lady with a broken leg. She had it in plaster, a lot of pain. And I prayed for her and I said, come on now, do something you couldn't do. Act it. She said, it's too painful, it's too painful. I said, come on, take a step. She went, oh. I said, take another one. She said, ooh. Take another one. Ooh. Take another one. She took off around the building. Tonight, I'm going to ask you to act your faith and do something you couldn't do. If you couldn't bend tonight, I want you to touch your toes in a little while. You have part of your body that's not working properly, your shoulder, your neck, your back, your Achilles tendon, whatever. I'm going to ask you to do something you couldn't do. I'm going to ask you to act it. Faith without an accompanying action is dead, being itself alone. Here's the keys in this miracle. The power of the Lord's present to heal. There's an action of faith just to come there. There's a tenacity to break through because faith is not passive. Faith seizes hold. Now faith is the substance, the hypostasis, the standing under and refusing to move on the things that are certainly and confidently expected. Then there's the action and the point of contact of faith. That point of contact tonight might be a hand laid on you. It might be a spoken word. Move your arm. Move your wrist. There's several people tonight that have... What's that typing thing? Is there someone with carpal tunnel here tonight? Just come. Just come. Just come, sister. Just come this way.
Jump down here. Now, how long has that been bad?
About 10 years.
About 10 years. Well, I think tonight's a terrific night for it to stop. You ready? Are you ready? What can't you do? Which one is it? This one?
Both.
Both. What can't you do very well?
My hands fall asleep.
Do they?
Father, right now, let your mighty healing
power go right through a body. Now. Now, let every trace of this thing go. Yeah, shoulder. Any problem with the shoulder? In your back, yeah. The healing power of God go right down your back, right down your back, right down your back. Start to move that. Just start to move that. Just start to move that. What's wrong, my brother?
I'm a mechanic.
Are you in pain?
Yeah.
Lift your hands. Lift your hands. Loose by the power of God. Start to move it. Start to move it. Stand up. Stand up. Help him up. Move it around. How's it feeling?
Feeling good.
Feeling good. Is it healed? Lift it up. Swing it. Don't hit Jeremy. Or you can if you like. I don't care. Just move it about. Move it about. Move it about. Tell me when that's healed. Do something that would really make it. Just give it a work over now. Test it. Give it a go. Give it a go. Come on. Come on. And? Go, every last trace of it. What's wrong, sir?
I dislocated my wrist about 30 years ago.
Yeah, which means that what happens with it?
I feel the cold more, and the mobility.
Jesus! You're going to believe God with you. What's wrong, bro? Is it getting better from last night?
Not especially, no.
Power from heaven. The power of God's here. God's here. The King is here. Presence of God's here. Come here, my brother. The Spirit of the Lord's all over you. Come up this way, bro. Good to see you tonight. I've forgotten your first name. What is it? Hey, Mark, lift your hands, my God. A power from heaven on Mark. Come here, sister. Did you get healed the other night?
You slept like a baby. Come up here. This lady wasn't sleeping well. Now she's sleeping like a baby. My God, I tell you, the Spirit of the Lord's all over you. I don't know if you need healing in your body. Do you need any healing right now?
He's healing.
He is.
I was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer, January 7th.
Okay.
And the Lord told me to tell them that my God was bigger than theirs. They wanted me to check into the cancer clinic. He said, you check in, you won't check out. So, okay, Lord, I give it to you. And then he said, against all odds, he was healing me. And last night he prayed over me.
Yeah. Every trace, go, 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 go. Every person with a neck problem, come right now. Neck problems. Listen, there's a ceiling. When I was talking about a ceiling, there's something that's been like that for a long time. And God's saying, if you'll aggressively get into prayer and break that. Watch me, guys. Listen, don't walk away, okay? Sorry, I'm not rebuking, but I had someone walk away, and I wound up in a court case, and I was 30 feet away. And it was at Hillsong in Sydney. And somebody went down the head 30 feet away. And I said, well, I don't know how they're going to sue me. I was miles away. Now, there's a breakthrough for you. And I believe there's a financial thing that's been held up. That somebody just watch this lady because the overflow's here. Trust me, I'm going to come back here, bro. Now, there's a breakthrough for you in finance. There's something that's been held up and is going to get unlocked. But there's also a healing and there's a breakthrough. What's wrong with your neck? What's wrong with your neck? Are you ready to be healed? Are you ready to be healed?
Yes, 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 yes.
Look, 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 look up, look up. Look, now! Your neck? Now! 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 Hey, sister. What's wrong? Would you know if you healed immediately?
Tonight, probably.
Tonight's a good night to know. Curb the anointing. Filled and empowered. You're doing a great job there, beloved brothers, in whom I'm well pleased. And you add Jezza, Jezzalenko, Adam. Are you ready, sir? Take your miracle. Take your miracle. Take it. Oh! Jesus' name. Right now, that's it. Right through your body. There's some restriction. Someone has some restriction that caused you to get faint. To a restriction, maybe it's of blood, different times, and you get quite dizzy and maybe fainting. Who's that? Who is that person? Just come right now. Come and stand right over here. Stand right there. Now listen, you got to grab this tonight. You've got to just lift your hands right there. You've got to grab this tonight. You've got to grab it. Look at me. Now, in Jesus' name. Now grab it. Now grab it. Now grab it. Power of God's here. But see, the power of God can be powerfully present. People still not get healed. Every person that has a situation physically with your legs, your back, your neck, your shoulders, that you have some restriction of some sort with it, I want you to just step into the aisle. Just step out of your chair into the aisle. Okay. All right. How many? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Come down this way. Come down this way. What's wrong with your shoulder, Brooke? You're just testing it to see if there is anything wrong with it. And you found there's nothing wrong. Is there something wrong? There's not anything wrong. It was broken. When? Have you had a healing? When? January. You're just testing to see there's nothing wrong that needs any more prayer. Good? That's fair enough. This is what you're going to do. I'm going to pray for you, and then you're going to act it. As soon as I pray for you, I want you to do something you couldn't do. Nikki, the grinning one. She's always smiling. Michaela's caught this. It runs in the family. Nikki, as soon as I pray for you, start to move it, move it. No! No! No, no, no! How is it? What happened? It what? You what?
You
mean prostate? What?
Is it healed?
So is it good?
It's good.
It's healed. Jesus. Speaking in tongues. Trying to explain in tongues to me, an Australian. We can't even understand American. It's all right, none of you can understand Australian. How's that feel, Sister Purple? How's the wrists? How are they? Are they feeling good? Is it good, is it? Just be blessed. Be blessed. Sister White Top, come here. As soon as I pray for you, do something you couldn't do. Stay with me, guys. How's that feel, bro? Brother Mark, how is it?
Yeah.
Are you healed? He's healed. That's what we're here for, a miracle. You ready? As soon as I pray for you, take your miracle. As soon as I pray for you, start to act it. As soon as I pray for you, start to move it, act it. Now! Start acting it. That's it. Now, help her to test it. My brother, what are you suffering with? Your knee. You ready? As soon as I pray for you, start to move it about. Jesus, right now. Right now, right now. Test it out, test it out. What are you suffering with, sir?
Actually, I'm also boxing for my wife.
Yeah.
She's got shoulder damage.
Hands up. No, in Jesus' name. Start to move, whatever. Hello, sister. Are you receiving something here right now? Why don't you just take it? Why don't you just... Oh, why don't you just take it? How are you going tonight, Paul? You having a good night? You've had a good... You've been every night, haven't you? Filled! Terry? Filled! Filled! Right. What do you need, my brother?
Spine fusion.
All right, you guys come right up with him. Come right up with him. What can't you do? Yeah. Okay, you see, you're fused. My God, in the name of Jesus. So you need a creative miracle. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus... In the name of Jesus, I declare your miracle power right now. Just watch him. Just watch the brother. And we'll get him to test that in a minute. Just start to move it a little bit. What do you need, sister? Well, watch it. What do you need? Right, fair enough. Receive that thing. Just feel. There is... a really nice touch of the presence of God here right now. It's rather lovely. It's rather salubrious. Isn't it, Dan?
Did you get to the glory? Are you ready? Are you ready to get your miracle? You got an opal. You got an opal. No, it's a diamond. Where's the opal? You got an opal, haven't you? That's an Aussie opal. Jesus. 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 Power from heaven. Healed. I tell you what, there is some strength in this room. If you just reach out and grab that right now, there's healing. If you have digestive, someone over here with digestive problems and someone over there with digestive problems, God wants to touch you. Is there anyone here that has one of your ears is deaf? Anyone with a deaf ear? Anyone with a deaf ear? Just come. If you want to come, just come. I'd love to pray for you. Jesus. There's power in that name. 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 There's power in that name tonight. Jesus! Let me tell you, the power of the Lord's present to heal. We've just got to grab it and act on it. Grab it and act on it right away in Jesus' name. You do. Come here. Come here, sister. Yes, come up. Yeah. Just stand right there. Well, she's lovely, this lady. She's just wonderful. What's your name? She was just saying, he's good. I'm just thanking her. She's just sweet. Got a sweet-spirited lady. You got, there's some lovely people here. You're all pretty lovely. A whole lot of you. Even Stuart. Sure, it looks after babies. This one is your baby sister. It is too. Hello. Hello. How are you? You ready? Ready? As soon as I pray for you, start to bend it, start to move it. No! In Jesus' name. Start to move it. What are we praying for, bro? Ready? Power from heaven. Take it. Move it. What do you need, sir? Shoulder? Which one? Are you ready? Power to heal. Lift it up right now. Lift it up. Bring him back up here. Did I hurt you then? Was that painful? Move it. How is it now? How's that feel? Is that good? Is that good? Is that good?
Praise God.
Lift it up. Hallelujah. Move it about. Move it about.
Hallelujah.
Move it about.
Praise God.
Move it about.
Glory.
Hallelujah. How's that? Is that? How long since you've done that?
Hallelujah.
How was it?
Great. Wonderful.
Power from heaven. I like him. Where were you born, bro? Philippines. Do you like balut? Yeah. Terrible stuff. Balut. What do you need?
Your back. You ready, sir? You need something as well?
My back, too.
Two backs. You ready? I pray for you, then I want you to start to bend. Father, I tell you, the anointing of God's here. You guys go in the right place.
Start to move it. I like to move it. Move it. I like to move it. Move it. I like to move it. Move. Tell me when it feels a bit better. Move it. Move it. Move it. How is it? How's it feeling, sister? How is it? Move it. Move it. Move it. I like to move it. Move it. I like to move it. Move it. Dave, how are you? It's Pastor Dave back there. Brother Dave, he's a friend of mine. just touched. How's it feeling? Tell me how it's feeling. Is it feeling better or the same? Same. Power from heaven right through that spine. How's your back, sir? Is that easy? That's the same. Power of the Holy Ghost. That'll fix it. That should fix it nicely. People are getting healed here in this building. Come, my friend. Let's touch these ears. Lift your hands all over the building. There's people tonight that are facing a ceiling in your finances. There just is no breakthrough. There is no breakthrough. Seasons where you sow and sow. The truth is, in due time, you will reap if you don't faint. But there's a breakthrough in your business. There's people here tonight that need creative ideas. Come here, Paulina. The Spirit of the Lord's on you. Come up this way. This lady's a sweet lady. She's just a terrific girl, this one. Oh, all terrific. All terrific. Creative ideas, financial breakthroughs, financial. Have you got your own home?
I'm sorry.
You got your own house?
Believe in God for him.
Yeah. My God. Open every door. Every door! God touch you, bro? Has God touched you tonight? What do you do for a living? Come here. Evangelist plumber, that's a good mix. We probably stand over here, bro. An evangelist plumber. Well, I like it. I like it.
I like it.
Breakthrough. 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 Everybody say breakthrough.
Breakthrough.
Everyone say breakthrough.
Breakthrough.
Into a new dimension. Into another dimension. Hallelujah. 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 Brookster, bring that row. Bring this crew. Four of them there, three of them there. The other end can come as well if they want to. Just come. Just come. Come, sister. You're in that row. What is this, Bush Week? Come down. In Australia, good to see you again. Lift your hands. Oh, God, the anointing. Yes, come. Help her up here. Just watch her. Just watch her. Bring Sister Giggling up here. Bring her up here. You know, I never tire of seeing the joy of the Lord. You get sick of the depression of hell. Somebody just watch, sister. That's it. Stay with me, brothers. Filled. Oh, there it is, a high-pitched little laugh. Jesus. 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 Oh. The Brookster. Good name for a den, the Brookster. The Brookster. Cousin of yours, Josiah? You must have about 85 cousins. Spread all over. From here to Oregon. Thousands of them. Jesus. watching at home, let the glory of God touch you. If you've got migraine head, you suffer with migraines, come here right now. If you have migraines, Jesus. 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 If you suffer with migraines, just come. I used to have them all the time. I used to get 3 a week. Don't get them anymore. Don't believe in them. Don't like them. I used to get all these lights and... Sorry? Yeah, strongly opposed. Exactly. Again them. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, that's the migraine sorted out. No one? How many still need a healing tonight of something? Just come. Just come. Just come. Randy, stand up if you would, brother, right at the back there. Someone stand behind him quickly. Someone just rush in behind him. He's not going to last long back there. You see what I mean? That's it. Someone, Rob, just step out in the aisle. I think Rob's going to cop it. Hop out, Rob. There's some of my old favourites, these blokes. Not that old. Favourite, though. Just lift your hands, Rob. Just lift your hands. Fire! Brad, you need another dose. Just step out. These guys, someone say, these guys are really easy to pray for. Yes, they are lightning rods. They're smashed when they walk in. But sometimes just need to be sort of put out of their misery and or put out of their whatever, you know what I'm trying to say. They just need a... Brad! Brad! Filt! Brad and I have had a lot of fun. We've been over aircraft carriers together. We've done a lot of stuff together. All right, let's just pray for these folk. Catches, come in with me, guys. If we can sort of make a line, that's good. Jesus! Jesus! Jesus, the anointing right now. Jesus, your anointing. To heal. Where's those two boys of yours? A couple of wonderful brothers. How you going, Bri? Brian, how are you, mate? Going all right? They're your blokes, aren't they?
No.
They're not? Which one's yours? Oh, Elijah's yours?
Yes, Elijah.
Oh, yeah, Elijah, of course. Yeah. And Michael? Oh, yeah, yeah. He'll come up, Michael. Are you going all right back there, Matt? Matty, doing well? How's your leg with the pig bit you? Recovered? He was out pig shooting recently, and the pig took to his leg. He just strangled the pig. They've got all the meat in the refrigerator. They've done pretty well. A very strong man. Stand up, Matt. Just want to see who you are. He's a hunter. He didn't really do that. I'm just lying. Just, you're not supposed to lie, are you? Gee, I'm just making a story up. It's a fine line as an evangelist. Jeez. Brother, you've had a pretty good clean up this week, haven't you?
Oh, yeah.
Power from heaven. Hey, sister, you ready? Take it down. Here's my brother. Power tonight.
Hello.
How have you been? Has God done some miracles tonight, this week? Yeah. Thank him for the miracle right now. Thank you. Come, sister, come. A good few. We've had a good time, haven't we? This week. Have you had a good time this week? Come up, sister. Can I come back again sometime? Is that all right? Do a few nights. A bit of a go. Soon. All right. Hands up. Jesus. Touch your Lord. Touch it. Touch it. Touch it. Touch it. Touch it. Touch it. Touched. You okay? Yep, let's get rid of it. My God, in Jesus' name, let's get rid of that thing. We command it to dry up and go out of your body. Tonight, in Jesus' name, go. Go. Go! Let's all stand. Let's all stand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to turn to the person next to them and look them right in the eye. and say, did you know that the joy of the Lord is your strength? And a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. Therefore, take some medicine right now. Here comes some. Ha ha ha. Hee ha hee ha. Hee ha 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 ha. Ha hoo ha hee. Ha 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 ha. Question. Who's had a healing over this week, in these 4 days? Lift your hand high. Lift it up. That's a lot of people have been healed this week. Been some great testimonies. Great testimonies. One last thing, and I'm going to quit. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Watching at home, you can just receive your miracle right where you are in Jesus' name. Put your hand on the sick part of your body. Take it now. All over this building, put your hand on the sick part of your body. Anything that's not yet touched, let the power of heaven go through you. Oh, she's over. Sister's gone. Is the furniture destroyed? Praise God. That's it. She's over. Filled and healed. I wonder if there are those tonight that do not know the Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe you're away from Him, backslidden. You've never come into that glorious relationship with the King of Glory and known what it is to have your sin washed away and to stand righteous before Him, but you'd like to know Him. If that's you, wherever you are tonight, in this building or watching at home on the internet, this is your moment. Everyone in this building that would say, Jesus, I need you tonight. I want to be saved tonight. I want Christ as my Savior tonight. I want to know that every sin I've ever committed is washed away. I want to know that I'm a new person in Christ, brand new. Then I'd like you, wherever you are across this building, just to lift your hand and say, that's me. That's me. Would you lift your hand and say, that's me tonight? Are there those? Quickly. Just give it a wave. If that's you, just give me a wave tonight. You're saying yes to Jesus. If you're worshiping, maybe put your hand down. If you want Jesus, lift it up. Okay. Those that would like to know Jesus, you worshiping or you want to get saved? Come down here. Did you want to give your heart to Jesus or the sister in the purple? Or was she worshiping God? You're worshiping God or? Okay. Anyone else? Sir, just come. You lifted your hand, said, yes, I want Jesus. Come right now. You've lifted your hand, said, yes, I want Jesus. Would you come? Anyone else? I want the Lord tonight. I want Jesus tonight. Just come. Anyone else? I'm going to ask Pastor Mark, the pastor of the church, my friend, your pastor, great apostle, great man of God, come and pray the prayer of faith. And you can have it from here, Reverend.
Father, we thank you that you bring assurance of salvation. You know, there's so many people, we've gone around different places in the earth and we see so many people come night after night, responding to the altar call. Sometimes we see same folks every night. They don't know how to take a hold of assurance of God's love for them. Tonight, not only the two that are standing right here, but I'm also going to believe the Lord for every single person in this place that struggles with the concept of how much God loves them, with how easy salvation is. Salvation, healing, the love of God towards you, transformation and change is the easiest miracle that exists. It is, Father loves us so much. He's already done the work. You don't have to convince God to do something for you. Tonight I want you to be able to see that Jesus Christ, the eternal God, died specifically for you. And He would have done it for you and only you if you would have been the only one in response. I want you to raise your hands right now. Raise your hands towards heaven right now. Father God, I thank you right now for assurance. I want you to say, Jesus. I want you to say, Jesus. I know that the power of your name is transforming power. Miracle power. I'm not going to doubt the power that is in your name. I receive this divine work of grace. I lay hold on that which you gave me. I will not release it for anyone, for anything. I'm yours. And Lord Jesus, you are mine. I'm going to serve you because you give me the power to do it. Holy Spirit, I yield myself to you right now.
I yield myself to you right now.
Siapro. Great confidence in Jesus' name. Now, in Jesus' name, great confidence. Power of the Holy Ghost comes on you. Out of your belly flows rivers of the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah. Now, there are many people, there are several people standing in here tonight. You've never received that which God has purposed to give you so that you can be a witness of Him, so that you can step into the school of the Spirit. God wants you to step into the school. Christ Jesus wants you to step in the school of the Spirit tonight. Somebody says, does everybody need to step in the school of the Spirit and be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire? Absolutely. That's the ministry of Jesus. His ministry is to baptize in the Holy Ghost and fire. Somebody said, what does that look like? It looks like Acts chapter 2. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all gathered together in one place. Suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and clothed in tongues of fire, came and rested upon each one of them. They all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Hallelujah. Ha, 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 ha. Yeah. And somebody said, well, I don't believe it's that way. Well, then you have to go ahead and write your own Bible and submit it to God to see if He's going to authorize it. I tell you right now, He ain't going to do it. So the power of the Holy Spirit's right here at this moment to baptize you in the glory of heaven, so that out of your belly will flow the nabo. The bubble is nabo. It literally, the Hebrew word nabo means to bubble, and from it we get nabi, which is a prophet, to prophesy. When the Spirit of the Lord came on people in the Old Testament, they prophesied. And when the Spirit of the Lord came upon anyone in the New Testament, they prophesied. But in a very unique way, the sound of a heavenly language began to utter forth out of their innermost being. And I want you to raise your hands right now, and I want you to submit yourself to the teacher. His name is the Holy Ghost. He's Teacher Holy Spirit. And Jesus Christ is the one who's going to take you and baptize you over into that realm of glory, so that right now, in Jesus' mighty name, out of your belly flows rivers of the Holy Ghost outflowing out now in the name of Jesus. Receive! Receive! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Father, I thank you for the anointing that's here in this life. Father, I thank you that there shall be faith to hear. Open those ears. I tell you, the anointing of the Holy Ghost on that man. He might be deaf right now, but his ears are opening up. His ears are opening up. I'm telling you. I see the power of the living God opening up deaf ears. I'm telling you. Listen, I see the power of the Holy Spirit shaping a man of God right here, shaping a vessel of the Lord. Hallelujah. The ears of the deaf will have no choice to live in the prison of doubt in the United States of America. I tell you, the religious Nazareth condition no longer will prevail against that which God should do to show forth the glory of His only begotten Son. I'm telling you, the day has come, that the time, the hour in this nation has come. Hallelujah. The blind will not remain unable to see. The most radical crippled, those who were born with neurotube defects, those who were born completely paralyzed, Father is going to do great extraordinary miracles by His holy child Jesus. Listen, He showed that to us. I've already seen it in the Spirit. These things God will do. And He's invited a lot of people to come and participate. And if you're willing, you can come. But you're going to have to press past the doubt and the unbelief. You're going to have to press past the things that have been able to trip you up in the world and the circumstances of your life. God's raising up a radical and a mighty, ferocious army. They run like lions. They run like horses that look like lions. They're ferocious people. If you thought you were going to see some soft-looking face in the church, I'm telling you, just not going to. It looks like a lion. It looks like a lion. It's boldness. It's authority. Hallelujah. If you thought we were just going to kind of stroll through the garden of God, I'm telling you, we're not. As they're running like horses, we're going to run on the city. We're going to leap over walls. Great is the army that carries out His word. We're going to carry out His word. He told us, these signs shall follow them that believe. In My name they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with tongues that have never been heard before. They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay their hands on the sick. The sick shall absolutely, without option, recover. Hallelujah. To have this. One night we were in China and in Beijing, and I was called up by the head of a big Baptist organization there, and he said, well, we heard about these miracles going on over there in Zibwa, and we want to come and talk to you. I said, if you want to come and talk to me about miracles, I'm happy to meet with you, but we're going to meet in a public place. Just pick wherever. And it was the Grand Hilton in Beijing. And they came in, and the man said, well, you know, I don't believe that Jesus does miracles today. I said, sir, why don't you believe that? He said, he's got all of his leaders there, and it's a lot of folks. He said, because I prayed for people, and they didn't get healed. I said, sir, have you ever been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire? He said, no, I haven't. I said, you're not authorized. You have not received power from on high. Jesus said it, and you're not going to cast down His word. And, of course, I was about that ferocious because that's the way God made me. And I said, sir, I perceive that you're sick in your body. And he began to tell me about his car accident, his back injury and his sciatica, how he's constantly in pain. I said, no, you're not. He said, I'm in constant pain. I said, no, you're not. He said, I said, no, you're not. He's looking at me like I'm crazy. And suddenly his face lit up. And for the first time in many years, he was not in pain. I said, there's something else wrong with your blood. He said, yeah, I have diabetes. I said, no, you don't. And he didn't argue that time. Hallelujah. And the Baptist went away believing that there was an opportunity for anybody who wants to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. I did not lay hands on them to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire because they weren't hungry. They need to go home and think about it. Because the baptizer is always around. His name is Jesus. That's His ministry. Against popular religious belief, it's His ministry. We want you to be authorized. The anointing will authorize you. Jesus says, you're not authorized to be My witnesses until you receive power from on high. Hallelujah. It'll make you dance. Hallelujah. This authorization, it'll make you shout. It'll fill you with joy. It will cause you to be so filled up with the goodness of God, you won't have room for nothing else. A lot of people got room, and they just can't overcome sin, and they don't know what it means to conquer and overcome the powers of darkness. Father wants you to understand. Father wants you to understand. You don't want to miss out on the greatest days of revival that has ever existed since the church began 2,000 years ago. Behold, it is at hand. Behold, it is at hand. It is at hand. Behold, it is at hand. You want to step right in the big middle of the of this wonderful divine opportunity and say, Lord, here I am. Use me. I don't want to live for any other reason. I don't want to live for any other reason. I just want to stand here in your presence. I have no other purpose to live but for you. For me to live is Christ. Say, for me to live is Christ. Tim, you know what the Lord recently told me? The Lord recently told me, he said, I'm going to send you around America, and I'm going to command you to speak into my people and say, receive the life of Christ. We're getting ready to see a great moving of the Holy Ghost in the churches of America. I'm going to say, by the Spirit of the Lord, to you tonight. And I want you to be ready. I want you to be hungry. I don't want you to have any defense, but Father God has given us an anointing that there is no defense against. Greater works means I can go into Nazareth and with the unbelief do mighty works. Ah! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Papa's going to do it for his mercy's sake, because of his loving kindness, because he understands what's going on. He sees the trap. He sees all the lies. He sees all the strongholds that have come and bound people through ideas and ideology and philosophies, Christian ideology and Christian philosophy. Papa, in his mercy, is going to break through into every person's life and say, behold, here am I. Tonight, in Jesus' name. Where's that baby that's crying? I want to pray for that baby. Where's that baby at? Just before I let you go, I want to pray for the baby. We're going to settle some things in your life tonight, lady. Get over here. You're going to quit waffling around on Jesus. You hear me? I'm pretty rough, huh? You listen to me. You're going to do things right now. That baby's not going to be tormented or harassed no more. Neither are you. Huh? Okay? How you like that?
Yes.
Huh?
I like
that.
Thank you.
He's a good diazana. He's a diazana. He's a vassal. Ninjas. Vinos. Zeta. Tonight, I set you free. Tonight, I set you free. I open up your prison door and I come in. Out of it and never go back in. Tonight I set you free. Tonight. Tonight. Hey, baby, you're feeling better now, aren't you? Because mama's feeling better. I give you my peace. Take it. Take it.
Baby's gonna be fine.
I get the baby. See, people try to cry and bring name things down out of heaven. We release things that have been placed in our lives. Holy Ghost, His temple, is tabernacling in us right now. Jesus in us flows out of us as rivers. Unlimited, forceful expressions of the divine power of the living God. I said, take my peace. I give it to you. Take it now. Baby's taking it. You take it. Take it in Jesus' name. Take it. Here, come on, there you go.
Listen, it's power, it's virtue that you can feel go out of you. And when it goes out of you, it goes into someone. Woman with the issue of blood said, if I could just touch his hem of his garment. When she did, the power went out of Jesus. He felt it go out of her. She felt it come in him. None of this little religious prayer going to do nothing. It's faithless. It would do nothing. When the power of the authority of the Holy Ghost is in your life, when Christ Jesus is in your life, there'd be a flow. Amen? Amen? Amen. Amen. One more time, I want you to lift your hands towards heaven. I want you to receive power from on high tonight. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I release unto you in Jesus' name power from on high. Power to be certified, authorized, equipped with divine ability to be witnesses unto Him and unto His resurrection. Yeah, that's it. That's it. Praise God. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Come on, lift up your voice. Come hum your way in heaven. Hallelujah. 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 Father, I thank you that in your mercy and in your grace, you pour out hungry, thirsty mercies upon your people, that they be so hungry, oh God, that they be so thirsty, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So thirsty. Somebody said, I got famine in my life. Then you need water. You need rain. The Lord said, I'll give you rain. Just be thirsty. I'll give you rain. And then the Holy Ghost has come to give you the capacity to be thirsty. Ma na 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 na